Hello everyone, welcome to tutorial 53 of our Golang course. In the previous lessons, we have discussed panics. However, this time we will dive deeper into understanding panic and recover and explore how they can be implemented in our code. Without further ado, let's commence this lesson. First, let us look at panics. In Go, a panic occurs when the program has reached an undesired state from which it cannot recover. We have observed this in the previous lessons that attempting to access an array element outside of its range results in runtime panic. If your program reaches a state from where it can no longer recover, you can create your own panics using the panic function. The panic function accepts a parameter of any type. Usually, it's a string indicating the error. When a panic is called, the code will print the stack trace of where the panic happened, and the call stack will return back to the main function. Panic's relationship with defer can be better understood by examining the flow of execution when a panic occurs. A flow diagram can assist in this understanding. So let's have a look at one. So here I have the main function, in which first we call a defer function, then function 1. So the call stack goes to here. Function 1 is called, which has another defer function, which is deferred, and then function 2 is called. The call stack moves from function 1 to function 2. Again, we have a deferred function, and then we call a panic. So here the panic occurs. What happens next? The behavior will be similar to what happens when you compress a spring and release it. Everything will unwind. So first thing that Go will do is call any deferred function. In this case, this deferred function will be called, and then it will return to the function that called function 2. The deferred function will be called again, and then we read the main function. Here, the deferred function will be called again, and then our code will panic, printing the stack trace to error. Whenever panic happens, keep in mind that the deferred functions are guaranteed to be called. So this is a general flow. We go from here to here, calling the function 2. And then when panic happens in function 2, the function 2 deferred function is called, followed by the function 1 deferred function, followed by the main function deferred function. So this will be the panic execution flow. Let's look at an example of panic. First, I'm going to create function 1. Inside it, we will call a deferred function, or register the deferred function call, which will say fmt println function 1 deferred function called. Now, let us create another function, function 2. This time, we create another deferred function execution. So basically, we are registering a deferred function. This time, I will just copy this and say function 2 deferred function called. And then we will cause a panic and provide a string saying function 2 panicked. Now, let's call function 1 in our Go code. You should be able to visualize what happens since we went over the flow of panic execution. Let's now see what actually happens. Before that, we forgot to call function 2. So let's call function 2 and function 1. And now let's run our program to see what happens. And as you can see, first of all, panic happened. And then Go called the deferred function in function 2, which is why you see function 2 deferred function called. And then the execution returns to here. Since this code panicked, we get function 1 deferred function called, or the deferred function is executed, as you can see here. And then we return to the main, printing the string from the panic. I can also add another deferred function execution here. Let's say main function defer. Now let's try to run the program again and see the output. As you can see, just like a spring, it unwinded function 2 defer function call, function 1 defer function call, the main function defer function call, and finally we panicked with the stack trace. And if you look through the stack trace, it will track back to the line that panicked, followed by where the function or where the panicking function was called, and then back to where that function was called. So that's how panic executes. Now let's look at the recovery mechanism for panic. There is a function called recover that can be used to recover from panic. Recover needs to be called in a deferred function, which makes sense since only deferred functions are called when panic happens. Please note that the value returned from calling recover is the argument provided to the panic call. Let's look at recover with an example now. I'm going to remove this and create a new function, panic example. Inside it, let's register a recover within a deferred function. Inside the deferred function, we can call recover. R here is the return value from recover, and if R is not is equal to nil, let's print it out. Recovered from panic with R. And then let's call panic with a string value says something went wrong. Now here in the main, let's add a print statement to say that the program has started. Then let's call the panic example followed by a similar print statement which says that the function execution has stopped. Let's now run our program to see what happens. As you can see, we started the program and then we recovered from panic when we called recover inside the defer function in a panic example. And the result was something went wrong, which was the string we provided to panic, which is R here, followed by exited function. So that's how you would use recover to recover from a panic. Again, remember that recover needs to be called inside a defer function. Now let's go through the uses of recover. The purpose of the recover function is to handle a situation gracefully and then shut down your code. It is not designed to act like exception handling in other languages, even though it is possible to do so. Usually, if you recover from a panic and continue the execution of your program, chances are high that the code will panic again and the panic may go unnoticed, which is not intended use of panic. It is common to create packages that are intended to be used by other Go programs. By using recover, you can translate that panic into an error that can be sent back to the calling program. Let's now summarize everything we have learned in this lesson. First, we looked at panics, which are a way of indicating that an unrecoverable state of things have been reached in your Go program. A very common example is range out of bounds for an array or a slice. Then we looked at recover, which is a function used to recover from panics. Please note that the use of recover should be limited to recovering from panic and providing ability for your program to gracefully shut down. It should not be used as exception handling. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. If you have any questions, please post a comment under the video or reach out to our Discord server. Until next time, happy coding.